Hi, I'm Radzi. Welcome to My World. This week, a special program on coronavirus with everything you need to know coming up. With many countries in lockdown to stop the disease spreading, we hear from teenagers forced to stay at home.
I'm just hoping that this whole situation passes like safely for our family and other people in like South Korea and like the whole world.
We'll have the latest on the rush for a vaccine, plus all you need to know about protecting yourself. And we'll share advice on what to do if you're anxious or worried about the coronavirus pandemic.
It may evoke feelings of worry, fear, feeling scared. It's really important that if you are feeling these things, that you talk to a trusted adult.
Countries around the world are taking drastic measures to stop the spread of coronavirus in what is now a global emergency. So over the course of this program, we'll be talking to those affected, getting up-to-date advice and discussing what you can do. First though, here's the latest. Across the world, streets are deserted as people are told to stay at home to stop coronavirus spreading. In lots of countries, school has stopped, shops are shut, planes are grounded, and borders are closed. Some of the world's busiest cities are eerily quiet. China was the first country to be affected. But while the rate of new infections has been falling there, the virus has spread around the world, with Europe particularly badly hit. Coronavirus infects the lungs. Symptoms usually start with a fever and dry cough. Most people recover quickly, but some can experience breathing difficulties. Older people and those who already have health problems can become very ill. Countries are trying to stop the virus spreading to help those people and to stop too many of them needing hospital treatment at once. So what exactly is a virus? A virus is an ultra-microscopic infectious particle. They can replicate inside the cells of living hosts, causing a number of different illnesses. The exact origins of viruses are unclear. But what is known is that they can pass between species. For example, scientists believe this particular strain of coronavirus could have originated from this seafood market in Wuhan, China, which sells live animals. So how can we treat people? Unlike bacterial infections, viral infections cannot be treated with antibiotics. Some respond to antiviral drugs, but most require a vaccination to prevent them in the first place. But developing a new vaccine can take years, sometimes decades. For this particular strain of coronavirus, scientists around the world are racing to produce a vaccine in record time.
We received the sequence from the Chinese government, and we worked overnight, and the next day we had designed a vaccine. We immediately put that vaccine into manufacture, and we hope that that will be entering into human clinical trials by early summer.
But experts agree it's likely to be more than a year before a vaccine becomes widely available. In the meantime, slowing the spread of coronavirus remains the priority. We know lots of you have questions about what's happening. So to answer some of them, BBC Health correspondent Catherine Burns is here. Catherine, thank you very much for joining us. And Catherine, first of all, under the idea that for many people this will be a mild virus, do you think there's been a sense of overreaction at all?
I really wish it had been the case. You're right that for most people it is a mild virus. So 4 out of 5 people who get this, they might feel a bit rough for a week. Some might not even notice it. But it can be very serious. And this disease, yes, the mortality rate's very low. We're looking at about 1% of people who get it then do unfortunately die. But the numbers are so high. So when you scale that out, it is actually quite scary. And I think the other thing is that, you know, young people, they do tend to be all right with this. But it's not just about you, it's about society. It's about protecting older people, vulnerable people, because you might be all right with it, but you could pass it on to someone who isn't.
And with that in mind, we're seeing lots of cities around the world essentially on lockdown, actually closing without any humans there whatsoever. Do you think that will work in actually helping stop the spread of coronavirus?
So the idea behind this is exactly what you said, is to slow down the spread. So right now, we don't have a cure or a treatment. So the best thing we can do is, and the phrase that everyone keeps saying, is flatten the peak. So here in the UK, for example, they were worried that they were going to have 50% of all of the cases in 3 weeks. There's no way the NHS could cope with that. There's no way really that any health service could cope with that. So what they're doing instead is using these measures, stopping us from going out. So the virus literally cannot spread. That way, the idea is that health services will be able to cope.
And Catherine, with that in mind, you're not going anywhere yourself either. You're currently at home, is that correct? Why is that the case?
Because upstairs in the loft, my husband has got all the symptoms of it. He's got the cough, the temperature, so he's in isolation. My kids, I'm bribing them with hot chocolate to stay quiet while I talk to you. Because this is the kind of thing that people are having to do. This is a way that we're going to stop this from spreading. It does mean that for most of us, our lives are not going to be the way we recognise them for some time to come.
Catherine, thank you for your time. We'll be back with you a little bit later on to talk even more about what work can be done to find a vaccine. Next, though, as we've heard, many people around the world are in quarantine at home. Some are choosing to isolate themselves, but others have been told to do so by their governments. Well, Nomi has been speaking to teenagers in Italy and South Korea to find out what it's like.
Andrea is 17 and lives in the north of Italy. He's been ordered to stay indoors by local authorities.
Give me a sense of how you feel.
I always like to keep calm, and but I cannot say that I'm not scared a bit, because I am scared a bit. Some people around me, like my grandparents are very old. Two of my grandparents are well over 80. So I may be healthy, but I may survive the virus if I were to get it. But some people around me may not.
What's the sort of thing that you would used to do but you can't do now?
I've not been going to school for the last 3 weeks. And I have been studying at home. We will have tests when we get back, eventually.
Jungo is 17 and lives in the capital city, Seoul. He has decided to self-isolate.
When I first heard about the coronavirus, I was like, oh, this is going to be another virus like the Ebola virus that really didn't affect South Korea as much as it did compared to other nations. When it became there were more and more people diagnosed with the virus in South Korea, these kinds of things added up, and then it just became this very terrifying hunting feeling that looms over our daily lives.
Is there ever any point though where you just feel a bit, oh, I just need to get out and go for a long walk?
It's kind of frustrating for me and a lot of kids at my age. Even though there are people who like to stay at home naturally on a personal level, this became this whole self-quarantine and social distancing became, I guess, it's getting longer and longer, and we can still talk and call each other, but it's different from meeting another person, or for example going to the beach or going somewhere to enjoy our day.
I cannot go to the gym, of course. Gyms and pools and bars, restaurants, everything is closed. Only necessities, shops are open, like supermarkets.
These are the government measures that have been brought in. What do you think of them?
I think they are necessary because it is we can call it a situation of crisis because the virus was spreading very quickly. And it is still.
I'm just hoping that this whole situation passes safely for our family and other people in South Korea and the whole world.
Now, washing your hands thoroughly is a key part of preventing the spread of coronavirus because soap and water break it down. So here's our easy guide on what you need to do. Washing your hands often and for at least 20 seconds is vital in helping to stop the spread of coronavirus. Not sure how to? Well, here's how, and make sure you watch until the end when we've got a special treat for you. So first, we create a lather. I'm gonna put it in the back of my hands, in between my fingers, do the ends of my fingers, my thumb as well. Again, my palms, my wrists, the top of my hands again. I'm going to rinse from my hands. But I'm going to use a tissue to turn off the sap to stop cross-contamination. So that's how to wash your hands properly. But now, here's your surprise. Still to come on today's special program, we'll have tips on how to keep your smartphone clean and the people offering acts of kindness during the coronavirus pandemic. Now, there's currently no vaccine available to protect people against the disease, but when could that change? The BBC's Richard Westcott has been speaking to scientists in the UK.
The race to find a vaccine for coronavirus didn't start in a lab. It started on a computer. Within weeks of the outbreak, the coronavirus DNA had been read and put online for scientists across the world to access.
The sequence helps us to understand how the virus actually looks in terms of its physical properties. And that's really important because the spike protein that you see around the edge of the virus, that is what we need the antibodies to attach to prevent the virus from entering our cells.
Things then move into a tightly sealed lab. They haven't got the actual virus in here yet. Their early tests are done on safer, man-made copies of parts of the virus.
This is a highly restricted lab. Very few people are allowed inside, and we are not allowed inside. But we are going to be able to talk to Jonathan, who's leading the research. Have you ever known anything like this in your career, in terms of the speed it's happened?
No, this is really, really unique. It certainly has spread globally very, very quickly. And it's caught everybody off guard.
They've already begun testing possible coronavirus vaccines on animals. But to be sure it's safe and effective, it could be next summer before a human version is finally approved.
Well, BBC Health correspondent Catherine Burns is back with us, and that's what's happening in the UK. But more scientists are actually working around the world, Catherine, I think it's safe to say, to try and find a vaccine.
Yeah, that's absolutely true. There's a lot of collaboration going on all around the world here. But we've got to be realistic. This vaccine isn't going to happen anytime soon. So if you think the first stage is going to be animal testing, after that they have to test on humans. And even if all of that goes really well, they've got to mass produce this. So we're looking at maybe 12 to 18 months before we get a vaccine. And when we do, you can expect certain groups, for example, health workers, to be prioritised. There is some good news here, though, as well. That's the vaccine. At the minute, there's no cure for this. There's no treatment. And treatments is where work is progressing more speedily. So what's happening is scientists are looking at certain drugs that already exist, for example, to treat things like malaria. So we know they're safe, we know they're cheap to make, and we know they're effective. And there are some really promising signs coming out of this kind of work.
It's fantastic to hear there's a potential light at the end of the tunnel. But in terms of knowing who to trust, there's an awful lot of misinformation out there. What would you say to anyone who's concerned about that?
Oh, this is so true. So even with me doing my job, I keep getting things from my family members saying, if you drink water every 15 minutes, you're not going to get it. If you eat more garlic, you're not going to get it. None of this is true. It's really important right now, when we're in such a scary situation, to only go with the really trusted sources. So that can be media organisations, obviously, the BBC, but also look to your government and look to international bodies, the World Health Organization, see what they're saying. These are the people you should be listening to, not your worried friends and family.
Well, Catherine, thank you for your time, and I hope your family stay healthy and safe. It's safe to say that these are such important questions to answer. But now the constant news about coronavirus can feel relentless. Understandably, it's making many people feel very anxious. So here's some advice on how you can cope with your emotions if you're worried.
If you're social distancing yourself like I am here today, it's important to remember to take care of our mental health and well-being. I'm Kadra Abdennasser, Head of Children and Young People's Mental Health at the Centre for Mental Health in the UK. Because of the news, it may evoke feelings of worry, fear, feeling scared. It's really important that if you are feeling these things, that you talk to a trusted adult. If your peers are feeling these things, also try and offer them support. What's important to remember as part of this is what you can control yourself. So trying to keep up with proper hand washing routines, isolating where you can, and connecting with your friends and family virtually if possible. There's lots of information circling online, and some of it can exacerbate our feelings of fear and worry. It's really important that you try to source reliable and trusted information, ensure that you keep up good breaks whilst using social media. These are really important for your well-being. It's also really important that you try and shut off all your online and digital devices an hour before bedtime and do other activities such as reading to really boost your sleep. We are all worried about our elderly relatives at this time, and some of us may not be able to contact them. It's really important that we try our best to stay in touch and support them, and you can do this online or giving them a call. There's other things you can also do, such as writing a letter to your grandparents or elderly family members. Your teachers will do the best they can to ensure you can continue to learn at home. And what I would advise you to is to try and continue to create a routine whilst you're learning at home. So things that you might have been doing after school, try and recreate those routines at home, try and incorporate exercise, and look up a new skill that you might want to learn. Your parent or carer will be receiving regular and reassuring advice from health services and from their work, and any implications this may have on their income moving forward. They'll also be told how to keep themselves safe and keep their families safe, and you too can continue to receive reliable information online.
Next, across the world, you'll have seen lots of people wearing face masks, but can they really help protect you from coronavirus? Let's take a look.
One of the reasons that people wear masks is they think that it's going to protect them from virus. But the virus isn't floating around in the air. So it's not protecting me against anything because it's not there. It's probably going to be on my hand because I've shaken hands with someone who's got the virus and I have transmitted it. I have carried the virus to my face. If you're in an environment where everybody else is wearing a face mask and you're not, then it may make you feel vulnerable because you feel like you don't have the protection everyone else does. But logically, if you're not close to people, they're not coughing and sneezing on you, then a face mask isn't necessary. So you don't need to go and panic buy face masks.
Moving on, it's not just washing your hands that will help stop the spread of coronavirus, but it's also important to keep surfaces clean. The virus can live up to 3 days on things like plastic, door handles, and even one of these. So here's how you can make sure your smartphone stays germ-free.
Hi, I'm Dr. Lena Sirik. I'm a microbiologist at University College London, and I'm going to show you how to clean your phone. Unplug your phone, turn it off, and remove the case. All the major phone makers warn against using chemicals, hand gels, and abrasive wipes on your device, as this can damage the screen's protective coating. Dampen a microfiber cloth with water and simple household soap. Gently rub the surfaces of the phone with the damp cloth. Take care not to get moisture in any of the openings because even water-resistant phones lose their protection over time. Finally, dry your phone with a clean microfiber cloth. Even just using soap and water can effectively remove bacteria and viruses from your phone, and we can test that by using this little device and these swabs. The device gives a reading of relative light units, or RLUs, and that's a measure of the microbial activity on your phone. So the higher the number, the more germs are present. We tested all of these phones and their cases before and after cleaning with soapy water, and they were all significantly cleaner afterwards. On a surgical surface, we'd want to get a figure of 50 or less, and all of our phones and cases had readings lower than that. If you have an iPhone, Apple says you can safely clean it with 70% isopropyl alcohol wipes. These are the ones that you can get from computer shops or online. Just remember, with all of these methods, as soon as you touch your phone, you're going to get germs back onto it. So make sure that you keep washing your hands regularly and thoroughly.
Finally, we know this is a worrying time, but all over the world, there are heartwarming examples of kindness and community spirit where people are looking out for each other. Watch this. As more countries are taking exceptional measures to deal with the coronavirus pandemic, people around the world have been finding ways to lift each other's spirits and have a bit of a laugh. Music has been ringing out from balconies across Europe. Even in lockdown, people need their exercise. So this fitness instructor gave a lesson that people could follow from the surrounding homes. But more importantly, kindness has been at the heart of a lot of people's responses. Applause for the emergency services has filled affected cities in Europe. And letters have popped up offering help to older isolated neighbours, whether that's with a visit or by popping to the shops. But not everyone's been on lockdown. These little guys, called Edward and Annie, have had a lovely time visiting their neighbours at the Shedd Aquarium in Chicago. With no visitors around, they've had the run of the place. Well, that brings to an end this special edition of My World, and also the end of Series 1. You can watch all the episodes again on the BBC My World YouTube channel, as well as videos, behind the scenes, and a whole lot more. But for now, from me, Nomia, and the rest of the team, thank you very much for watching My World. Goodbye. If you liked that video, I hope you did. Subscribe here, because there's plenty more where that came from.